welcome back to CCTV's News Bulletin with many interesting topics. An interview on global hazard communication, a statement on socio-economic analysis and authorization processes, and first some sound bites from the sessions on Latin America with Rose Passarella.
This morning's seminar was fantastic. Latin America and South America are regions of great industry and resources. But with that comes the responsibility that they have to take care of their chemicals in a sustainable way, which means they have to promote human health, environmental health, and innovation. They are many unique countries, but they're coming together with collaboration in order to face the challenges of knowledge, sharing their knowledge, prioritizing what needs to be done, organization, governments, and also the fact that they recognize that they need to do more to protect the human health. And the presentations this morning dealt with individual countries, but then also with GHS, which includes communication of hazards, and trade associations and trade agreements.
I just tried to show a little bit on how the Brazilian legislation is organized, the main steps and the main sets, principles, and everything that builds the text. And I presented a little bit also about the next step that Brazil is working on to send the text to the Congress and to gather the necessary stakeholders to put the legislation into place and make sure that Brazil will comply with OECD recommendations.
I'm very pleased to participate in this morning seminar. I have the opportunity to share experiences with other colleagues from other countries in Latin America. I presented the current regulation we are working at from the Colombian government, the scheme for industrial chemicals control, the program for prevention of major accidents, and the implementation of the GHS in Colombia.
The current chemical control legislation developments in Latin America are exciting, almost electrifying, which brings me to Benjamin Franklin, who was the first to take charge of electricity, creating scientific words still used today, like battery, positive, negative, conductor, etc. Mr. Franklin, can you tell us something about your groundbreaking electrifying experiments?
Well, I'd be delighted to tell that story. I was never before so engrossed in any study that totally drew my attention, such as electricity. It was a storm-tossed day in June of 1752. My son William and I ventured forth from our home with a small kite made of a silk handkerchief. Affixed to the top of the kite was a stiff length of metal wire. Down by the bottom of the kite string, I had tied a key and also a Leyden jar, which was a rather primitive battery. You might call it battery 1.0. We went to a field outside of the city. The thunder and lightning were happening, and as I looked up the kite string, I could see the fibers standing out, rather like a cat's fur after being stroked. I decided this was time to try my experiment. I slowly brought my knuckle close to the key, and a spark leapt across and struck my hand. It was very, very exciting. The electricity continued to flow into the Leyden jar, where it might later be discharged with usefulness.
A great invention. We cannot imagine our world today without electricity. You probably have seen horseless carriages driving through town. Cars. And you might remember your meeting in Edinburgh with James Watt, who made major improvements to steam engines. After steam cars, we used fossil fuels. Kind of your Franklin stove in a car. And now we're in the process of making a major transition to electric vehicles away from fossil fuels. This will improve our air quality in cities tremendously. Now, let's zoom out from Philadelphia and take a global approach in our interview on global hazard communication. The standard GHS, I assume you have implemented all 50 shades of purple?
That's always a ever-expanding challenge, and it doesn't seem to have an end. The challenge we find is simply the fact that we are a large organization with challenges in unique markets. Staying up to date with those trends and having safety data sheets prepared in time are always challenging our staff that we have today. The biggest problem, of course, is where we do not have staff in local jurisdictions and where we have to cover those requirements as we come up to them. We've establishing numbers of standards that are compliant with our major markets and the minor markets as we go. But we are, it's always an ongoing project.
Another topic, auditing of your hazard communication programs. Jessica, why is that essential?
Well, we all want to make and sell products that are safe for their intended use and also compliant to applicable regulations. So it's essential that you have a hazard communication auditing program so that you can review the processes and procedures you have in place to ensure compliance.
And how are you preparing for audits?
One of the first things you can do is conduct a self-assessment that allows you to look at the programs you have in place to ensure compliance and develop a baseline of where you are today. And then you can develop goals for where you want to be with your program in the future and strive towards those.
And if you define the goals, then you have a kind of scope of your audit. How would you define that?
Some goals of an audit might be making sure that all the right people are included in a product review, or ensuring that the local teams are looking for new regulations as often as they need to be. And so then you can use those as goals and establish timelines to meet those goals as part of the audit.
What are your lessons learned for company hazard communication programs and audits?
The need for globalization in a team. We can't just work in one location and assume we can meet our compliance obligations everywhere. And harmonize systems and tools and standards, which we have to deploy across the organization.
And I think our biggest lesson learned is hazard communication regulations are a bit of a moving target. So we need to have management systems in place that can handle all of the changes that are happening rapidly across the globe.
Communication is indeed very important. Sometimes small things make clear statements. For instance, the lighting rod, another Franklin invention. Franklin advocated lighting rods that had sharp points, but his English colleagues preferred blunt-tip lighting rods. And when an English colonial building in North America was equipped with lighting rods, the decision became a political statement. Most important reason for Franklin to invent the lighting rod was to protect people and buildings from lighting. Correct?
That is correct. I invented that device to steal the electrical fire from the clouds and conduct it safely into the ground, thereby protecting buildings and people's lives from that most mischievous element, fire.
Can you tell us more about the time when you invented the Philadelphia Fire Department?
Oh, yes. When I was 30 years of age, I was a volunteer firefighter. In that day, we fought fire by throwing water from leather buckets, and we used linen bags to go into burning buildings and secure valuable property. Later, we formed the Union Fire Company. This was a distinctly American effort to work together and not draw upon the government for our help, but upon the citizens of the community. Interesting statue, by the way.
Originally, there was a sculpture called Penny Benny, made out of 80,000 pennies. Probably due to your expression, a penny saved
is a penny got.
Nowadays, people still throw pennies at your grave, actually. And the money collected goes to Christ Church, the church that you and your wife, Deborah, visited.
Perhaps they should throw $100 bills.
That's the spirit of a true bon vivant. Will you join us tonight at the social event?
I'd be delighted to. Where is it located, Jared?
That's a secret we normally do not disclose.
Three can keep a secret if two of them are dead. Would it help to be dead?
Not really, but I guess you will respect the fact that I do not disclose the secret, since you are the master, or should I say grandmaster, of secrets yourself. A topic that might still have secrets for some of us is the socioeconomic analysis, something I will discuss with Rudy Colacico from EPPA. Rudy, welcome.
Thank you, Dirk. Thank you for inviting me here.
Can you tell us more about the role of an SEA in the authorization process?
Sure. The SEA is one of the key documents of the dossier that the applicant should provide to authorities in order to get the authorization. And the document should highlight the main costs and benefits for the European Society in case the company will not get the authorization. And the main focus should be on the economic impacts along the supply chain. Derived from the impact on business.
And your statement is?
No full-fledged SEA, no authorization.
Rudy, thank you very much for your statement. Looking forward to seeing you tonight at the social event. And now it's time for the focus of the day. Our spotlight this morning is on Europe, with ECHA's focus and strategy for 2020 and beyond. The quality of REACH exchange, Brexit, REACH authorization and restriction, and microplastics. In the afternoon, we take a practical approach on the supply chain by looking at the communication from hazards to risk while ensuring risk-based safe use. After such a long day, Franklin probably would say,
early to bed and early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise.
But there is an exception to every rule. Tonight it could be wise to attend a social event. Thank you for watching, enjoy today and tonight.